you so, so much. Uptron the hair, Nishi on shop, Nish Akatoshi on shop, Igoni, President of Ireland, you're not here right now, but you're always with us. Loretta, Ambassador King, there's so many people to thank. Minister Fitzgerald, Hugo, Kieran, Adini Ushla. It's more honored them on Dusha Hoyle in Massimo Meter Fane. Tommy Eaton brought you with us, Oxgrab Mila Margaret Galair. I'm incredibly proud to get something like this and to come home. You know, I just got in on a plane this morning. I was coming in from Colorado, and as I was flying, I thought about a flight that occurred about a century ago. When two men stepped out of the horrors of the First World War and they stood in a field in Newfoundland, which was then America and Canada. It was 1919, and so much of what the world was about was testing the pulse of the wounds that they had, the century, the early century, had experienced. At least 15 million deaths, and a world trying to recover some of the dignity and the grace that it should have been afforded. Alcock and Brown, two British airmen, they climbed into a Vickers Vimy, a thing that looked kind of like a flying dragonfly. Canvas, wire, a little bit of steel, two Rolls-Royce engines. And they set out from that field in the hope that they'd land in Ireland. And they went small against that big American sky. And over the course of the next 19 hours, they flew through fog, through rain, through snow, even though it was June, through all sorts of possibility. And what you have to imagine is two men up in the air in an open cockpit of all things, thousands of feet in the air, leather jackets on, battery-operated wires moving through their Burberry clothing, a little flask of whiskey, God bless them. They had tea and sandwiches. The edges had been cut off the sandwiches too. And they'd been made in the Cochrane Hotel back in a little town in Canada. So they flew without a radio using a sextant underneath the stars. They left in the middle of the afternoon. And then they flew blind where some of their instruments went out. And the snow even whitened the cockpit around their feet. If you can imagine this. At one stage, they plunged from at least 9,000 feet and fell in a complicated spiral all the way down through the clouds. And they were sure they were about to smash and hit water when about 50 feet above the water, they dipped out from underneath it and came out and rescued the plane. An extraordinary thing, all clouds, all whiteness. And one can only imagine the thrill they had in seeing the west of Ireland. And in fact, they first recognized the Marconi Towers in Clifton as they came on through. They circled around the town. Everyone was at mass. Those were the days. The first ones to greet them were the soldiers in the who were dropping out from the Marconi Towers. So it looked like a green field when they came down, but it was actually a bog. And they got, the wheels of the plane got caught in the sedge as they were coming through. So the plane was sort of lifted up in the air as it kept going, and they remained perpendicular to the ground. The first thing they said was, yesterday we were in America, but I think they must have said, oh Jesus, or something like that, or blimey, or crikey, or something like that. But it struck me that in ending up perpendicular to the bog, it must have looked like some sort of modern-day dolmen of sorts. And what do we know, I was thinking, but that our days become dolmens of everything that we are doing at any particular time. It was the first ever transatlantic flight. It was 1919. So I was put in mind when I had my own long flight, but that was a flight of ease. And it struck me then, of course, on a very simple level, that nothing's done until it's done first. and how many thousands of flights have gone across our oceans since then. This great world of ours, spinning. But I'm not interested in nostalgia here, nor do I feel any of that longing or saudade, that beautiful Portuguese word, saudade, for the world as it once was. Someone first crossed the ocean, but the fact of the matter is we must keep on crossing the ocean. And so what I mean here essentially is that good work, like good stories, must continue to unfold on a continuous level. And it strikes me that the Ireland American Fund is flying, I don't know what Kieran said, but I think he said 70 million Vickers Vemmies across our various oceans this year. It's transnational, it's transcontinental, transatlantic, transformative, and transimaginative. The fact of the matter is that the times that we're in and the challenges we have are, funnily enough, no less daring than those that were posed to Alcock and Brown all those years ago. I think we have to hunker down and keep on doing something new, letting the world unfold in front of us. Whether that be on an extraordinary level like this evening, or whether it be like looking after the Belfast Circus, or looking after Fighting Words, or the Cork Academy of Music, or any number of projects, or you know, the associations with the Fatima Mansions, the wonderful things that are done through the Worldwide Ireland Funds on a tiny, supposedly anonymous level every day, but also then on a gorgeous global level. What it means to me personally is a sort of ongoing form of storytelling, that each project is able and allowed to tell its own story. Let's not forget that it can be dark, it can be very dark, and it can be difficult, and it can even fail. And there's no harm whatsoever in failure. The Irish economy maybe failed and failed some of its people right now. But the fact of the matter is that if you're brave enough, just like our president said this evening, there is sometimes a vivifying air in failure. That sort of air that fills up your lungs and gives you the sense of the eternally possible. So what's at issue here is not just the Irish soul, but the human soul and how it endures, how it gets across from one side to the other, how it makes those mythical journeys that all of you enable. By telling stories, and by making these moments of our lives unfold, by looking after these projects, big and small, we allow the Irish narrative, and in fact the international narrative, to endure in the best possible way. We face survival by telling the truth, or at least the best version of the truth that we can come up with. Literature, like philanthropy, should oppose the monstrous cruelties, break the silence of various events, speak of experience, however bitter or lacerating. It should discover the hope that the words will somehow, eventually, be heard. So the suffering of the present or the evil of the past is unlikely to be redeemed by an era of universal happiness. I don't believe in that. And the president, she said tonight, as much, it's ongoing. All of this must be looked at time after time after time again. There is no cure, but there is an availability of somehow salving the wound. There's no naivety in our optimism. Don't let anybody say that our optimism is sentimental. It's full of sentiment, yes, but it's not naive in any manner or means. In fact, I think it's much bravery, because literature, like decency, like philanthropy, can be a stay or a foothold against despair. Can't necessarily cure these things, but it certainly can stop so much of what is going on. So it strikes me that it was very important for me to say that what you do matters. It truly, truly matters that your deeds are struck with an axe and that they give off sparks. You do not know where those sparks are going to land, but they do, in fact, land. Mine is a pale imitation of having an axe, but like Seamus Heaney and all of the other previous recipients of this fantastic award, which is a great, great honour, I will go on digging for it. And I take enormous pride in Irish literature, Irish storytelling, and Irish people doing the sort of thing that you're doing tonight. And I'm humbled. I'm humbled to be here. I'm truly humbled to be here, and to be with friends. I want to make a small word of thanks. I'll stop soon. A small word of thanks to a couple of special women. First, like every good Irishman, you have to thank your mammy. My mammy is in Dublin. She's not here tonight, but she's here in all sorts of ways, along with my brother Sean and his wife Frida. I'm really happy to be here. Then I have my wife, my beautiful wife, Alison Hawke, who's in New York, but she's also here. I miss her and my kids. Next, there's the Irish woman who has shaped our imagination in the most extraordinary way. I think she has treated the mighty weapon of power with dignity and equanimity and grace, President McAleese. With Ciarán, I believe that she and her husband Martin have made us extraordinarily proud of our country. I could stand up in the very worst storm, be it economic, be it cultural, be it social, and I would take any weather that they throw at me, just so I could sing the strength of what she has represented down through the years for all Irish people and Irish women in particular. And then finally, with great happiness, I want to thank Loretta Brennan Glucksmann, the sort of woman who opens up the windows of every single room she walks into. What luck I have, I give to my country, I give to my family, and then I give to my friendships. And she has been a tremendous friend to all of those down through the years. Yeats wrote of an Irish airman up in the sky, going through, he said, "My country is Kiltartan Cross, my countrymen, Kiltartan's poor." Well, Ireland is lucky to have a person who looks after not only Kiltartan, but all the rest of us around, and that's Lorena Brennan Glucksmann. It's an impulse of delight, an absolute impulse of delight, that I thank her for everything that she has done. Lorena Brennan Glucksmann.